Welcome back to Class Act, Updates in Education Law. I'm Miriam.
I'm Lisa.
And we are attorneys at Walter Haberfield in Cleveland. We practice school law, and every few weeks we get together and we talk about the latest legal developments relevant to board members, administrators, school employees, really anybody who works with kids in our schools.
Right, Miriam, and today we are starting our in-depth look on Title IX, which is a really fascinating but also very broad law, and it affects both school districts and also higher education universities and colleges, and in many ways, from how they address student bullying to sexual violence, employee discrimination, transgender issues, and even school sports. So we are going to dive into that topic today and explore background, really how the law has developed in key areas for board members and educators to kind of have some background knowledge to understand why these things are in place. And as we discuss that, we have our colleague with us, Ben Chonacki. Welcome.
Hi, Ben. Welcome.
Hey, thanks for having me here. I'm excited to dig into this exciting topic. I get to work in this stuff a fair amount, and it's pretty interesting. The law itself is relatively straightforward, but as with anything, once you start trying to apply that to real-world situations, it gets pretty dicey.
So Ben, can you give us a little bit of background just about this law, Title IX? What is it? How did it come about?
Sure. So Title IX is the ninth chapter of in the Education Amendments Act of 1972. It's arguably the most famous chapter in law, but there's a lot of confusion regarding its enforcement and compliance. The act was enacted as a follow-up to the Civil Rights Act of 1964. Mm-hmm. The Civil Rights Act of 1964 famously prohibited discrimination in the workplace and public accommodations on the basis of race, religion, sex, national origin, the traditional protected classes.
But that only applied in the workplace, right? It didn't apply to schools.
Correct. So that shortcoming became apparent as the act was enforced and implemented. It was clear that there needed to be an accommodation specifically for females in education programs.
Mm-hmm.
So legislators drafted this separate law, which became the Education Amendments Act of 1972. And the law itself is relatively short.
It's pretty short.
So, right, yeah. So even though it affects many broad areas, the actual language we pull from is pretty direct, right?
Correct. It's kind of a standard legislative practice. They paint with a broad brush and then start to fill in through administrative regs and executive agency interpretations.
So let's give them listeners that language.
Sure. So the legislature in the act, Title IX, the actual meat on the bones, provides that no person in the United States shall, on the basis of sex, be excluded from participation in, be denied the benefits of, or subjected to discrimination under any education program or activity receiving federal financial assistance.
So basically, if you receive federal funds, you cannot discriminate based on sex in any education programs. And that's it. That's the whole law.
Correct. Right. Yeah, there are certain exceptions for religious institutions and military schools and so on, but generally that is the law. Now the focus initially was on athletics.
Sports, right? School sports, for some reason. Even though sports is not actually mentioned in the law itself, from what I understand, correct me if I'm wrong, the initial cases, that was all about school sports.
Correct. So sports is one of the kind of the obvious examples where there's a clear disparate treatment, particularly in the 70s, between men and women. So mm-hmm. it was a clear and easy advocacy point to say sports is not equal right now. Let's get it equal as soon as possible.
And just to be clear, Title IX applies not only to colleges and universities, but also to K-12 school districts.
Correct. So Title IX applies to any educational institution receiving federal financial assistance. And that includes private colleges, private state educational institutions, whatever the case might be.
And one of the main ways Title IX is enforced is through the Office for Civil Rights, which was established in, I think, 1980. Can you tell us, Ben, a little bit about the Office for Civil Rights?
Sure.
And its role?
Yeah, so the Office of Civil Rights is a federal agency. It's run by the Secretary or the Assistant Secretary of Education.
Mm-hmm.
That person is appointed by the sitting president, and their job is to enforce and interpret Title IX and the corresponding regulations. So there are regulations that inform what this statute mean? So there's a code of federal regulations that say, what does it mean for no person shall, on the basis of sex, be excluded from participation?
So there's many details that are part of this law, even though they're not explicitly in the law. And those details are fleshed out, is that what you're saying, by the regulations which are developed by the Office for Civil Rights? Is that how you frame it?
Yes, there's two pieces to it. So there's the actual federal regulations, which are codified in the Code of Federal Regulations.
Okay.
Those regulations are specifically articulated, and they have the force of law.
Okay.
They go through a rulemaking process where the executive agency, in this instance the Department of Education, takes a law or takes proposed laws, and they publish them. The public gets to comment on them, and there's a comment and back and forth period.
There's notice and comment period.
Correct.
And that's done so that the public has a chance to weigh in on these regulations.
Exactly. So it's quasi-legislative, but it has the effect of law.
So we've talked about OCR often in our podcast prior and other areas, mm-hmm. and their role in enforcing these with school districts, following up on complaints, investigating, and giving this guidance. We've talked about Dear Colleague letters before.
Correct.
And those are often one of the modes that OCR gives guidance to K-12 schools.
Mm-hmm.
So how have you seen OCR's involvement with Title IX?
So big picture, the OCR gets involved because those regs are somewhat ambiguous.
Mm-hmm.
And so what the Office of Civil Rights does is their job is to make sure that any educational institution receive federal financial assistance is complying with that law.
Okay.
But in order to accomplish that Herculean task, one of the things that they do is they publish these Dear Colleague letters. These Dear Colleague letters typically say, the regulations say this, we interpret this to mean that.
Okay.
And the idea is that although it's not law,
it's
guidance to the educational institution receiving federal financial assistance for how they need to comport their activities on a going forward basis.
Okay, so we have the law, and then we have regulations that explain the law, and then we have the guidance from the Office for Civil Rights that further clarifies the regulations as they apply to schools in a practical way.
Right, and sometimes these Dear Colleague letters or guidance can be kind of controversial because it doesn't always go through that comment period. So sometimes when OCR is issuing mm-hmm. these Dear Colleague letters, it's their interpretation of these regulations and how they should be applied in these environments, but without the role of kind of the full legislature process.
Yeah, I think that I've heard about this in the news a little bit, where people get upset that the notice and comment period was skipped over, so they feel like a government agency just put forth regulations or put forth guidance without any input from the public. Is that kind of?
Yeah, I think that's accurate. So one of the things that gets really dicey is these Dear Colleague letters, these policy interpretations are articulated by an administration, an executive agency, and the executive agency's taking instruction from the executive.
The president.
Precisely. So what you have is a situation where, unlike the statute, which doesn't change, or the rules, which are really hard to change,
right.
Every 4 years you get a new administration, and that administration is likely going to have some different interpretations of that law.
Mm.
And the challenge is, and there's no clearer example than what you see between the two terms of the Department of Education under President Obama and the Department of Education under current President Trump.
Mm-hmm.
Those regulations or those that administrative guidance has gone one way, and then with the election of President Trump, it's gone another way.
So a good example would be like the transgender issues we've talked about previously and can dive into in another episode a little bit more, where there had been specific guidance and it's been withdrawn by the Office of Civil Rights.
Exactly.
So let's dive into a little bit more of how OCR enforces these laws and what that looks like.
Sure. So the Office of Civil Rights, they have brick and mortar offices, and those offices are in different jurisdictions throughout the country.
Okay.
And there are parents, students, anybody who's involved or related to or has standing to bring a claim or an issue where they are or someone they are responsible for is experiencing discrimination in an educational program.
On the basis of sex?
Correct.
Okay.
If they are receiving that, or if they are subject to that type of discrimination, then the Office of Civil Rights is tasked with the investigation and enforcement of the law.
So in other words, a parent files a complaint saying, you know, my daughter was treated differently because of her sex, because she's a female mm-hmm. in this school environment. And that can be a college setting, or it can be high school or elementary school even.
Correct. And so that arises in a lot of different contexts. And it arises everything from in the athletics context. You've got just the example of there's 20 men's sports to one female sport. That mm-hmm. that type of dichotomy gives rise to a Title IX investigation.
That seems to be the more common area that the public knows about.
I would say that's probably the more high profile but less frequent example. Probably the more frequent example and the more common cases are actual instances in the classroom or in other extracurricular activities where you have teachers or administration mm-hmm. responsible for ensuring programs are administered in a non-discriminatory fashion
okay.
who either intentionally or unintentionally are providing those educational benefits in a way that is disproportionately affecting one sex or the other.
So like grading girls harsher would that be an example?
So that's an example. Mm-hmm. Usually it's more along the lines of discipline. You'll have an individual who's potentially in trouble for, we'll say, an act of violence.
Mm-hmm.
The Title IX complaint might come in because they're saying that, well, this institution, if incident A happens and it's a male, that person gets this type of discipline. But I'm a female and I received tenfold more discipline, and it's because of my sex.
I was treated harsher because
correct.
Of my sex. Okay.
And as a consequence of that harsh treatment, I'm being deprived of an educational benefit.
Okay.
And that's where the Title IX violation comes in.
Okay.
Once you start being deprived of that educational benefit, mm-hmm. Title IX is implicated, and OCR's job is to investigate and prepare a report, and if necessary, reach an agreement or potentially litigate the matter of noncompliance.